As far as the purpose behind transitions, have you ever been in a worship service where maybe it's a three-song set and the worship leader basically welcomes everybody, has everybody stand up, you sing three songs, and then you sit down, and you're like, what just happened? What there, you know, it's like there have been worship times where I've sung three great songs and felt like I just went through the motions. Because especially if it's songs that are familiar or that I've sung before, it can be a real danger to allow some of those songs that we've sung over and over again to just kind of become second nature. And I'm a huge proponent of repetition, I believe that the more, you know, not that we would repeat songs until they're dead, but definitely the more we repeat songs, the more familiar it becomes to the congregation, and the more they're apt to sing out and participate. But with that, there's a danger then too of those words becoming kind of second nature, where they kind of go in one ear and out the other. So for us as worship leaders, it's our job to kind of help take those lyrics to a little bit of a deeper level for them. Maybe it's a song they've sung 40 times, and you're wanting to kind of allow those words to dwell in their hearts new and afresh. And so those are great opportunities for us as worship leaders to add depth and meaning to the lyric. Whether it's just adding a scripture at the beginning, a related scripture that we set up the song with. One of the most effective things that I've ever done is anytime that I'm going to offer any kind of an exhortation or a transition in worship, if I can make it personal or I can apply it to something in my own life, it makes that transition like just that much more powerful. It's much more effective for me to say, hey, you know, when my wife and I first got married, we struggled with having children. And so 5 years into our marriage, we were basically given the news by the doctors that we only had about a 20% chance of ever having children. And it was at that point where we put our complete dependence and our trust in God, understanding that He had a perfect plan for us, that whether we were to have children or not have children, that we were going to trust Him and know that His plan was what was best for us. I used that as an opportunity to set up the song Another in the Fire, which we taught probably about 8 months ago. And this was brand new for our folks. They had never sung this song before. But I used that personal story to set up the song. And I will tell you, I have never heard our folks sing a brand new song louder and more confidently than they sang that song. And it was amazing because I really believe that the Holy Spirit used that little personal touch, that personal testimony, to add meaning to the lyrics that they were singing. It kind of brought it to life. So anytime you can add a little bit of a personal story into your setup, do that. You want to, you know, you want to, a little bit of vulnerability can go a long way, but it also shows your congregation too, that you're spending time with the Lord, that you are growing in Him, that you're spending time in His Word, and that what you're doing on Sunday morning isn't just kind of going through the motions and singing a bunch of songs. The other thing too with transitions that I feel are effective with transitions, sometimes we'll sing songs where they're very poetic. And a lot of my congregation is an older congregation, and so a lot of them are very literal. And so they love the lyrics to a lot of the older hymns that are kind of, you know, very, very straightforward, very literal. And with some of the newer modern worship music, there's a lot of poetry involved, there's a lot of imagery involved. And my goal is that when I lead people in worship, understanding that there is a diverse crowd, and that there might be people in the congregation that don't know Christ yet, I want to provide as much clarity as I possibly can to the lyrics that we're going to be singing. So taking 20 seconds, taking 30 seconds, just to provide clarity to maybe a phrase in the song that's kind of poetic, that might not be easily understood by everybody in the congregation. Can go a really long way to provide clarity for that song as you're leading it. So that they, when they get to that part in the song, they're like, oh, okay, that's what he was talking about. Okay, well, that makes sense. So that's why I feel like verbal transitions are really, really powerful. And with verbal transitions, you know, obviously scripture is probably one of the best ways to transition. If you can't go wrong if you're using scripture, right? And my encouragement is that if you're going to use scripture to set up a song, have it memorized. If you don't have it memorized, at least get them to put the words on the confidence monitor. I've made the mistake of not memorizing scripture before, and I pull out my phone and it just looks really tacky, especially when your phone isn't working and the scripture doesn't come up when you want it to. So my encouragement is if you're going to use scripture for a transition, memorize it or at least have it up on the back wall or wherever you have your confidence monitor if you have one. Another really good way to transition, I feel, is just prayer. I mean, when you think about worship songs and you think about what they are, basically they're prayers set to melody and rhythm, correct? We're offering our prayers to the Lord many times. And so a lot of times, either whether it's at the beginning of the song, in the middle of the song, at the end of a song, just finishing up with a prayer that kind of echoes the theme of what you've been singing. That's a great way to provide a transition. It's not bad to practice your transition. I mean, I know all of us as worship leaders, we want to be as spontaneous as possible, but this is like probably for the first 5 to 8 years of me leading worship, I had to memorize and practice what I was going to say between the songs. Part of that was just because spiritually I wasn't in a place that I really should have been. And so for me, I had to kind of, the spontaneousness didn't come as much. And so I had to plan it out. But even with that, I think it's super wise to go ahead. And if you have a transition you want to put in a worship service, practice it, practice it, practice it. I don't think there's anything wrong with practicing your transition. It will help bring clarity. I don't know about you, but when I'm in the middle of leading worship and I get to a place where I'm transitioning, there are probably 42 things that are running through my head. For some of you, you're also the band director, right? So you're also trying to guide the musicians. You're also trying to think about, oh man, am I going to go overtime? And is my pastor going to be mad at me for taking too much time? You know, there's all these things that run through our minds. So the more that you can practice your transitions in advance and even memorize them, you'll find that as you do that, as you practice that and do that, those more spontaneous ones will begin to come more natural as time goes on.